capital of Pavasa Nepia at the moment. How phenomenon first proposed by old Wilman Adler and expanded upon by Christian Hugin. Nepia at the moment, a momentary, fleeting details in the filming shot which your viewer finds him or herself fixating upon. They are often drawn towards the river, fleeting details. So fascinated with these details, you just are. The term was coined by Paul Goodman in his 1994 essay, Through the Glass Darkly, Snappy and Reconsidered. Wilman was describing a phenomenon which kept cropping up in writing about a film. They are momentary, fleeting details in the filming shot. Take you through a few of my cinephilia moments tonight. Christian Keating further develops the idea of cinephilia moments in his 2007 book, Cinephilia and History. They want to talk about these moments and explain why they are obsessed. They are usually details at the back of the shot, not necessarily intended by the director. Small details which make a film seem more real. They stick in the viewer's mind, such as wind stirring trees in the background of the shop, giving the film an air of authenticity. Connected at moments can be blinks or winks or glances. It could be how an actor says a line. It could be something in the background or a detail which resonates personally with a viewer. Can anyone here think of an example, perhaps from their own experiences? To shed further light on this idea, I now like to take you through three of my own cinephilia moments. The Union Jack parachute jump from The Spy Who Loved Me. The first sighting of the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park. What I call the RHAP scene from First Contact. This idea, I now like to take you through three of my the parachute jump scene from The Spy Who Loved Me as James Bond, played by Roger Moore, skiing down a slope pursued by bad guys. He skis over the edge of a cliff, seemingly to his death, but at the last moment his parachute opens in blazing with the Union Jack. This scene is obviously to thrill viewers, but I think it has more resonance with me due to its physicality. I know what it feels like to fall, so to see someone saved from falling in such a dramatic way perhaps acts as a kind of wish fulfillment. Anyway, that reality played into the film, drawing me into the place of protagonist. After all, who doesn't want to be James Bond? Also now adore it even more because it was reused at the 2012 Olympic opening ceremony. No doubt you'll recall Bond escorting the Queen to the D-Mat. The reuse of the flag in place of parachutes can only have been an odd of this scene.
this is my fault that this didn't work.
Next nephew at moment is from the first Jurassic Park film. It's where protagonists first see the dinosaurs, a herbivore or a pod. Obviously, the audience is supposed to feel exhilarated at this moment. The magic of the cinema is seemingly resurrected ancient sauropods. Reverse shot to display both the dinosaurs and characters, the viewer is prompted to feel amazed. This much is, to a certain extent, obvious. Yet, there is more to this sequence. I am filled with wonder and enthusiasm at this shot, feelings that exceed the cinema. The shot seems to remind me, and again you will have to forgive the cliché, of the wonders of nature, of the marvels of science. I simply find it beautiful, even if I can't really say why.
Sorry, it's the volume, isn't it?
Yeah.
was coming for the spirit, because he wasn't. Just keep going, you know.
We are at sea. It's the very pivotal romantic scene in First Contact. It's very dialogue-driven. I like it. It presents these to me personally, so to speak. It's where Captain Picard, determined to carry on fighting the war, is persuaded by Lily, the agenda, that he's acting out of revenge. She accuses him of being Captain Arnold. They remind me of a time when I felt similarly upset. As someone with a disability, I've lost many of my disabled friends over the years. This thing takes me back to that time. I believe I see the rage I felt then in Picard's eyes. Yet the way in which Picard realizes at the end of the scene to fight the Borgies folly also reminds me that railing against disability, the very thing which took my friends from me, is folly. After all, Arhat's quest was motivated by the fact he was made disabled by the white whale and the equipment I used to communicate had moved around our enemies into Borg implants, which in turn evoked Arhat's whale bone leg.
Sorry about this, I realised what I've done wrong, but if you just bear with me. That's all I've done.
Throughout my body. I was linked to the hive mind. Every trace of individuality erased. I was one of them.
You son of a bitch.
This really isn't the time.
Okay, I don't know jack about the 24th century, but everybody out there thinks that staying here and fighting the Borg is suicide. They're just afraid to come in here and say it.
The crew is accustomed to following my orders.
They're probably accustomed to your orders making sense.
None of them understand the Borg as I do.
No one does. No one can.
What is that supposed to mean?
6 years ago, they assimilated me into their collective. I had their cybernetic devices implanted throughout my body. I was linked to the hive mind. Every trace of individuality erased. I was one of them. So you can imagine, my dear, I have a somewhat unique perspective on the Borg, and I know how to fight them. I you'll excuse me, I have work to do.
I am such a pity. It's so simple. The Borg hurt you, and now you're going to hurt them back.
In my century, we don't succumb to revenge. We have a more evolved sensibility. Bullshit!
I saw the look on your face when you shot those Borg on the holodeck. You were almost enjoying it. Oh, come on, Captain. You're not the first man to get a thrill from murdering someone. I see it all the time.
Get out!
Or what? You'll kill me? Like you killed Ensign Lynch?
There was no way to save her.
You didn't even try. Where was your evolved sensibility then?
I don't have time for this.
Oh, hey, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt your little quest. Captain Ahab has to go hunt his whale. You do have books in the 24th century.
This is not about revenge.
Liar!
This is about saving the future of humanity!
Don't blow up the damn ship!
No! No!
You broke your little ships. See you around again.
And he piled upon the whale's white arm, the sum of all the rage and hate of my soul breast. If his chest had been a cannon, he would have shot his heart.
What?
What we did?
Actually, I didn't do it.
Ahab spent years hunting the white whale that crippled him. The quest for vengeance. But in the end, it destroyed him and his ship.
I guess he didn't know when to quit.
Prepare to evacuate the Enterprise.
They stick in your mind, so much so that you can become obsessed with them. You must think about them and look forward to them every time they watch a film. Sometimes you watch a film just so you can watch that moment. Rather than being about the plot or character, this is about the simple joy of watching and relishing.